Good morning, Springs Church. Welcome to the Springs Online. We're glad that you've gathered to worship with us this morning. Let's begin together in Ephesians chapter 5. Everything exposed by the light becomes visible, for everything that becomes visible is light. Therefore, it says, sleeper, awake, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you.
Welcome, Springs Church. We are so glad that you joined us here on live stream and on YouTube Live and friends Facebook Live. We're just so glad that you joined us this morning and glad that you're with us. As we gather together here this morning, I want to remind us of the faithfulness of God. He is good, and His mercies endure forever. I pray over the weeks to come that we will stay nimble and flexible before God, ready to be the hands and feet of Jesus as needs arise. Let us lean into the goodness of God and trust that He will lead us. I want to remind you that we need each other during this time of social distancing. Check in with each other daily. If you're not in a connections group, please give us a call and we'll connect you to a group. I know that my connection group personally just discovered the Marco Polo app, which allows us to give short videos to each other each day. And each day the group checks in, we do a short video of just little simple joys of life, a short video of someone baking bread with their children, a bedtime story, a joke. These little simple joys of life bring a smile, warm a heart, and connect us. It's amazing the light and joy that come from the simple things. We need each other. We're growing a list of helpers also. So if you are ready to be a helper, please let us know and we'll add you to the list of those that are ready to jump into action when needed. And if you need help right now, let us know. We have an army ready to go to help you. Right now, we don't have too many requests, but we are ready to be responsive to your needs. Despite social distancing, we will walk through this season together. We will share, we will serve, we will love each other, following the example of Jesus our Lord. Our scripture reading for this morning is Psalm 23. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right paths for His name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for You are with me. Your rod and Your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord my whole life long. Would you pray with me? Lord, we thank You for Your faithfulness. We pray Your healing presence over our families, our city, our nation, the world. We ask that You help us be responsive to those around us. May we be Your hands and feet as we seek to express Your love and grace. Father, be with us in the days ahead. May we reflect Your glory and love. We love You. And it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Let's continue our worship together in song. My foes are many, they rise against me. promise is true, and my God will come through always, always. I lift my eyes up, my help comes from from the Lord. We lift our eyes up, our help comes from the Lord. From you, Lord, from you, Lord. Yeah. Oh my God, He will not delay, my refuge and strength. Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
As we enter a season of worshiping and living far from one another, now more than ever, we need to remember that the Spirit of God cannot be contained by a building. It cannot be confined to a structure made by human hands. Psalm 139 famously asks God, "Where can I go from your Spirit? Or where can I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there." When we ask the Spirit to come flood this place, we don't just mean this room. We mean your room. We mean your neighbor's room. We mean every room in this city, this nation, and across the globe. Even as we're separated, in one voice, we ask the Spirit to fill the whole earth with the knowledge, the glory, and the healing of God. Let's praise Him together.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. No thing can compare. You're our living hope. Sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood. There's nothing worth more that will ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your
become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness.
Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us sing. the glory of your goodness. Let us become more aware of your presence. Let us experience the glory.
Well, good morning. Kelly began this morning for us reading Psalm 23. That psalm has been on my mind for a good couple of weeks now. As our nation and communities are responding to the spread of COVID-19, I found myself actually reciting Psalm 23 as I wash my hands. It's a good way for me to time that, make sure I'm washing properly. But this practice has filled my heart with such sweet memories. I remember memorizing that psalm in Bible class as a little girl. I remember singing that psalm with more than one church family to more than one tune, because there's definitely more than one out there. And so these words have been written on my heart for a very long time. I have found comfort in them in seasons of darkness and conviction when I am tempted to believe that the world should revolve around me. So much so that I have even, I opened my Bible to that this week and I had written a paraphrase that I thought I would share this morning. The Lord is my leader and provider. He guides my heart to peace and restoration. He leads me to right actions for the purpose of making his name famous. Because he is always with me, guiding and redirecting my steps, I will not submit to fear, even when the darkness of this world threatens to overwhelm. At your table, I have all that I need, Lord. No enemy can take away your presence or your provision. I trust your goodness and mercy now and forever. This good shepherd is in Psalm 23 is described and actually came to earth as a human. And Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. I lay my life down for the sheep. I have other sheep that do not come from this sheepfold. I must bring them too, and they will listen to my voice, so that there will be one flock and one shepherd. This is why the Father loves me, because I lay my life down so that I may take it back again. No one takes it away from me, but I lay it down of my own free will. I have the authority to lay it down, and I have the authority to take it back again. On this fourth Sunday of Lent, we extinguish a candle to recognize the darkness that grew as Jesus walked toward the cross, the Good Shepherd, offering his own life to save the lives of his sheep. Would you pray with me? Go ahead and sit down. Lord Jesus, we proclaim our dependence upon you and our loyalty to you as our good shepherd. We submit to your guidance and strive to be your light in this disorienting season. As we are scattered across our cities, our states, our nations, and even across the world, submitting to physical distance for the purpose of protecting the vulnerable, unite us in spirit as your one flock, listening to and following you, our one shepherd. Make your powerful presence known in each home and in each heart as we celebrate the meal you gave us to remember you, the life you lived on earth, your selfless sacrifice and brutal death, and your authority exercised over death in your resurrection. And we pray in your name. Amen.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Thank you. treasury found. Sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, mount of thy redeeming love. Great is thy O God, my Father, there is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever wilt be. Great
mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
Welcome in the name of Jesus Christ. I have a confession to make right off the bat. This is strange. It's strange for me to be up here on camera, and it's got to be strange for you. It's just different. We don't usually do this. This is not our practice. And so just to break the ice of how strange and awkward this may be, although Kelly and Leah and Brett and Laura done a fantastic job this morning, I want to break the ice by beginning with a practice that we normally do, at least at times here at the Springs. Today is my wife Kim's birthday. And so I want all of Kim's friends to join with me in singing happy birthday. Happy birthday to you, happy birthday to you, happy birthday, dear Kim, happy birthday to you. It's good and right to celebrate life. And my wife Kim is 29 years old today. It's amazing how she keeps her youth. It is strange to be in this situation, but it is right and it is good for us to do this. For this is how we love one another, protect those who are vulnerable. It is the loving thing to do. And so for however long we have to do this, we will be committed to practicing worship together online. There's another confession that we got to make. To be real honest, these days there is a lot of emotions happening. You may be feeling confusion or disorientation. I mean, there's new things coming out in the news all the time about this virus. There's stuff coming up all the time about what it is and how it can be contracted and what the numbers are and is the death toll rising. It's confusing. We don't even know how long this is going to last. And so many of us are feeling disoriented, confused. Our lives are disrupted, and that just feels strange. You also may be feeling fear and anxiety. Fear about your health. Fear about your parents and your grandparents. Fear about those who are most vulnerable to the virus. You may be feeling anxiety about your kids. Are they going to be healthy? How do I keep them healthy? Is there going to be any school? How long will they be out of school? You also may be feeling frustration and anger. Frustration at the situation, at the disruption to life, at the uncertainty. anger, in this feeling of being powerless, and maybe even being cooped up all day long in tight quarters with your family may produce a certain amount of tension. You may also be feeling quite a bit of boredom. The amount of movies that you can catch up on these days, the amount of binge watching of TV, if there is ever a moment, this is the moment. In fact, I saw a news article that in Europe, Netflix and YouTube is reducing their streaming speed so that the internet won't break. So many people are on the internet, Netflix and YouTube, streaming movies. And the things people do when they are bored. I've been watching clips online of people doing a challenge where they're juggling toilet paper to see how many times they can juggle toilet paper. That is, if you can find toilet paper. I also heard a story about a man who poured dishwashing soap all over his kitchen floor and then used the slick surface as a treadmill to get exercise and to clean his floor at the same time. You may also be experiencing loneliness. Being isolated from one another sharpens our sense of how much our relationships give us life. And when we're apart from one another, we are reminded that God has made us for each other to be in relationship. And so when we're not in relationship, when we can't be around each other, we experience loneliness. And for you who are an introvert, congratulations. A 14-day self-isolation is like a dream come true. But no matter what you are feeling, all of these feelings are appropriate. It's okay to be vulnerable. It's okay to feel all these things and even more. And so if you're watching and you're watching on the live stream on Facebook, there's a section where we want you to contribute your comments. We want you to be able to participate. Whatever you're feeling, share that with others in the live stream. We actually have missionaries, some of our missionaries from around the world that are watching. Say hi to them. Chime in. Connect with one another. For this is not just affecting us here at the Springs. It's affecting the entire world. But the one thing that I think that all of us are experiencing is a real sense of disbelief. And what I mean by that, it's like we're all living in a movie. I don't know how many times this week I've heard the phrase, "These are crazy times." Or the phrase, "I have never experienced something like this in my entire life." And so we are in this series, Gathered by God. And if it wasn't ironic last week, when only half of us were sitting in this room, it is for sure ironic this week, where you are sitting at home and I'm standing up here in front of a camera. And trying to talk about God and how he gathers us when you and I have, in a sense, never been so far apart physically. I don't know of any other time in this church's history where you and I and others have been so far apart. In our own homes, separated from one another. And so the real question is this. How can God gather us when we are so scattered? When Brett and I started thinking about this sermon series, we actually scheduled today to read Psalm 44. And the title of this sermon today is Gathered in Exile. When we planned this and assigned today for Gathered in Exile, there was no way we could have imagined the circumstances and the situation. Being here, you watching online, feeling exiled from one another and from our lives. And so it's appropriate and maybe even providential that we read from Psalm 44, the word of the Lord. We have heard it with our ears, O God. Our ancestors have told us what you did in their days, in days long ago. With your hand, you drove out the nations and planted our ancestors. You crushed the people and made our ancestors flourish. It was not by their swords that they won the land, nor did their arm bring them victory. If your right hand, your arm, and the light of your face, it was that because you love them. And you are my king and my God, who decrees victory for Jacob. Through you, we push back our enemies, and through your name, we trample our foes. I put no trust in my bow. My sword does not bring me victory. But you give us victory over our enemies. You put our adversaries to shame. In God, we make our boast all day long, and we will praise your name forever. But now, you have rejected and humbled us. You no longer go out with our armies. You made us retreat before the enemy, and our adversaries have plundered us. You gave us up to be devoured like sheep and have scattered us among the nations. You sold your people for a pittance, gaining nothing from their sale. You have made us a reproach to our neighbors, the scorn and derision of those around us. You have made us a byword among the nations. The people shake their heads at us. I live in disgrace all day long, and my face is covered with shame at the taunts of those who reproach and revile me because of the enemy who is bent on revenge. All this came upon us, though we had not forgotten you. We had not been false to your covenant. Our hearts had not turned back. Our feet had not strayed from your path. But you crushed us and made us a haunt for jackals. You covered us with your deep darkness. If we had forgotten the name of our God or spread out our hands to foreign gods, would not God have discovered it, since he knows the secrets of our heart? Yet for your sake, we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. Awake, O Lord! Why do you sleep? Rouse yourselves. Do not reject us forever. Why do you hide your face and forget our misery and oppression? We are brought down to the dust. Our bodies cling to the ground. Rise up and help us. Rescue us because of your unfailing love. Psalm 44 is set in the context of exile. In 722, the Assyrian Empire comes into the northern part of Israel and they take them captive. And they deport most of Israel off to Assyria. But then in 587 BC, the Babylonians, some 135 years later, come into the southern kingdom and they take lots and lots of God's people and they deport them back to Babylon. And a few things happen that really make sense of this text for us. One, the walls of Jerusalem. When the Babylonians come in, the walls of Jerusalem are totally dismantled. The center of God's promise to Israel was in shambles. The whole structure of Israel's community life came apart. Plans canceled, economic hardship and uncertainty, relationships disrupted, fear and anxiety over the future. There's frustration and anger over the disruption and the feeling of powerlessness and the disbelief. I can only imagine how many times the phrase, "These are crazy times," was said. Or how many times someone said, "I have never seen anything like this in my life." all signs of stability, all that seemed guaranteed by God's faithfulness, all that gave symbolic certitude and coherence, all that was linked to significance, identity, and security was completely gone. They were not gathered, but scattered. For some still were living in Assyria, while others were taken off to Babylon, and still others remained in Jerusalem under occupation and complete lockdown. And finally, the temple's been destroyed. In effect, God's dwelling among his people was gone. And so it's no wonder that in verse 9, the psalmist says this, "But now you have abandoned us." And if there's no temple, how could God be present with them now? If God is not present with them, how could he gather? How could God gather us when we're so scattered? You know, one of the most remarkable features of the faith in the Old Testament is that in exile, in the experience of disruption and displacement, this threat does not produce despair. But what is amazing about the faith of this story about the exile in the Old Testament is that it doesn't produce despair for God's people, but it is actually an event that produces hope. It is in exile that God's people learn to hope, because it is when they are scattered that they learn that this is precisely when God is with them. Laura read earlier from the psalmist in Psalm 139. It says this, "Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you're there. If I rise on the wings of dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you." I want to say this to you this morning, that just because we are in a moment of self-isolation, that does not mean that you're alone. There is no place, no situation, there are no circumstances, no amount of distance, no amount of darkness, no amount of self-isolation that can hide you and I from the presence of God. God's Spirit is with you, and you are not alone. And if God's Spirit is with you, and is with me, and if God's Spirit is in you and in me, then we are connected even though we are apart. And we are gathered by God's Spirit even if we cannot be physically close to one another. This phrase, social distancing, has been a phrase we've become very familiar with these days. You could probably look it up on the internet about how many times the word social distancing has been used, but it's a phrase that we've become very accustomed to. And I'm hoping that we're practicing it for the sake of our neighbors. But I want to say this, is that just because we are self-isolating does not mean that we're alone. And if God's Spirit lives in you and lives in me, and that connects us to one again, that together to one another, then I want to say this as well, that social distancing does not mean social disengagement. If God is engaged and present with you and I, then we are called by His Spirit to be engaged and present with others. You don't always have to be in the presence of others to be socially engaged. We do want you to practice social distancing, but social distancing does not mean that you're not socially engaged. It's amazing the ways people have been able to connect over the past few weeks. In fact, I saw this video on the news, and you may have caught this as well, that where the epicenter of the coronavirus is in Italy, people have found a very creative way to connect with one another. Not just over the internet or not over social media, but actually in their community. You may have seen this video, but if you haven't, watch the screen. It's amazing the ways that people are connecting with one another. And you saw the hope and enjoyment that people shared with one another just by getting out on their balcony and singing together. I hope that's what we've done this morning, and I hope there'll be more creative ways to connect with one another. Because social distancing does not mean social disengagement. For if God, by His Spirit, is not leaving you alone, then we shouldn't leave each other alone. Connect with your neighbor. See if your neighbor needs anything. Don't be afraid to connect by text or by phone or by FaceTime someone in this congregation. Connections groups, stay connected. I've already heard of several connections groups that have video conference to one another. Or like Kelly said earlier, they've discovered the app Marco Polo. This story came up, and I'm sure you saw it if you look on Facebook. John McCurdy shared this story. He said that a few days ago that Jane Loafman gave him a call. And because they have to be isolated, because they are more vulnerable, the McCurdys are more vulnerable to the virus, that Jane gave them a call and said, hey, what do you guys need? And so John said, well, my glasses, one of the pads in my glasses broke, and I really need another pad in order to be able to wear my glasses. So Jane called Monima Stevens, who is organizing our benevolence, and she is the person to call to connect to if you need something or if you want to volunteer to help out. And Monima said, you need to call Aaron Trigg. Aaron works at an eyeglass store. And so Aaron was able to get a pad for John's glasses. And someone was able to take that iPad for the eyeglasses to John McCurdy. That's just one of several stories. That's just one of several ways that we could be committed to socially engaging with one another. We do want you to keep social distance, but social distancing does not mean that you are socially disengaged. And if you need help, please, please reach out. Call the church office. And if you're willing to volunteer to help go get groceries or to be of service to others, let us know. We'd be happy to send you on an errand. In exile, Israel's stability, Israel's certainty, Israel's security, they were all canceled. Their plans and their normal interactions with people were canceled. And it seemed that the presence of God and their very lives had been completely canceled. I heard it said by someone this week that while so much is being canceled, hope cannot be canceled. It is in exile that God's people learn to hope. Because it is there in exile when they are scattered that God's people learn that it is precisely when God is with them, gathering them for his purposes. I want to finish today by reading the words of Paul from Romans chapter 8, beginning of verse 31. What then shall we say in response to all of these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for all of us, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation, even the coronavirus, will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Overcome.
We'll finish with this benediction. During this time of scattering and isolation, may the Spirit of God be with you and in you, and that you may know that you are not alone. And here's our challenge. Practice social distancing. But social distancing does not mean social disengagement. Connect with one another. Serve one another in this season of exile. For it is in exile that God's people learn to hope. And because it is when we are scattered that we learn that this is precisely when God is with us and gathering us for his purposes. May the Spirit of the Lord be with you all. Amen.